Monday nights can mean one thing and one thing only here on RaceSpot TV. It's time for another round of Club UK and Ireland Monday Night Skippys here on RaceSpot TV in support of Shelter. Wolverton along with Rachel Whiteford as we are about to kick things off here at the legendary Autodrome in Monza. But yesterday saw some incredible excitement on Sunday Night Skippys. We expect to see exactly the same thing here on Monday night. We start in just one moment's time. It's Monday night, and that means it's time for Club UK and Ireland Monday Night Skippys here on RaceSpot TV in support of Shelter. It's the final round of this, our fifth season of coverage here on RaceSpot TV of Monday Night Skippys, and it means we head back to the Autodromo Monza for the final round of the championship. Now, we have a champion already. That guy, his name is Tom Ward from Friction Racing. We kind of expected that one to be the case, but even though P1, P2, and P3 are pretty much all said and done, they were going to help Fahim Akinidez, Clark Williams, have a nice little scrap of their own for P4 through P6. So yes, you may have Friction Racing as your champion, and yes, PH Racing may be in P2 in Mark Mercer, but that doesn't mean that we're going to have a boring race here today. Will Vincent, Rachel Whiteford, RaceSpot TV, the final round of the season. Our aerial coverage here today is brought to you by An Juan Design, the official graphics partner of RaceSpot TV. 1 minute until these drivers head themselves down, Rachel, to the starting grid. Qualifying here, well, it doesn't mean much at all, does it?
It does not indeed. And like last week when we were at Oran Park, where Dave Grinnell had the chance to take a race win, but just couldn't quite make it stick. He made a mistake. He'll be kicking himself this week, Will. Sitting on provisional pole right now. So expecting this one could well be his second chance. And, well, not many friends for him at the moment. But looks like Tom Ward's friends from Friction aren't here either. So could be an exciting race of people trying to find someone to dance with. Stuart Anker up at the front. He had a mistake last week as well. He will want to correct that. So expect him and Grinnell to be sticking together like glue.
Yep, 147 car there. You can see Robert Plumley on pit road. Qualifying is done. Let's have a look through your starting grid, because I never wanted to dance with nobody like you here on RaceSpot TV. Don't forget, Sunday Night Skippies, they take place every Sunday night, except for this Sunday, because it's week 13. So it's on Saturday for the Skip Barber 2K World Cup Eliminator. That's here only on RaceSpot TV, as now we take you to your starting grid here for round number 12 of 12 here on Monday Night Skippies. And David Grinnell will start on pole position. Qualifying time of 2:14.154. Stuart Adcock alongside him, front row of the grid, 43 one-thousandths of a second back. If we see that gap at the end of this race, that'll be a long victory. Fahim Akinidez in third, with Amara Lawson in the fourth position. Tom Ward, championship elect in P5, with Bill Fraser in sixth, Clark Williams in seventh, and Mark Turner in the eighth position. We will cycle it on back here. This a smaller grid than what we're used to here on the final round of the championship, but that doesn't mean we're going to get ourselves a boring race. You can see a total of 19 drivers have qualified. 21 drivers are getting themselves set to go racing here tonight. So, ladies and gentlemen, for the final time this season, welcome to Monday Night Skippys. We'll be with you starting in 2 weeks' time for our sixth season's worth of coverage. Yes, I say that right. Season number six. That is how long we've been doing this series for you. And we continue to do it as a service to Club UK and Ireland here on RaceSpot TV. We look forward to bringing you even bigger, even better coverage next season. As they can see, the drivers are lined up on the starting grid. It's not long now until they get themselves those lights a-revving. In fact, that's going to happen now. 12 laps here at Monza. Drivers on the starting grid, ready to go racing. And the final round of the championship will start right now with a good start there by your pro couple of rows as they come down in towards turn one for the first time. The objective here is don't crash on corner number one. 19 drivers heading themselves down in towards turn one. There's a battle for the race lead already as down to the inside will go the number 52 car of Adcock in towards turn number one. Just about going to make that one work. Atinides will slot himself into the third position. Adcock leads away, then Grunhill, then Atinides, then Tom Ward up into P4. Mara Lawson into P5, Rachel.
It was indeed some bumping and banging in turn one, but everyone survived facing the right way. Pete Newman had to take to the escape area on the side, but he's made it. Patterson involved in tapping a few cars, but in general, everybody survived, so patience was a virtue here. But the last four or five cars separated now by a small margin, and I think we had something just go wrong in turn. No, we didn't. Everyone survived that as well. So heading into the Les Mars, there's the cars and field still largely intact.
Yeah, they were trying to go three wide there into Lesnar number one. That wasn't going to work under any circumstance. Behind the dust they come. Two wide racing. Robert Plumley, 147 car, and Simon Maltby in the number 16 machine is behind. You've got Adrian Bidwell going side by side with Alan Patterson. Oh, that's going to be Bidwell turn around there in the number 10 machine. He and the AM racing car, Rachel, is out of the race.
Yeah, Adrian Bidwell there not doing too well whatsoever. Unfortunate end to his race in this final round of the season. Just a second end, the exit of Les Mars 2. Such a difficult corner there, and that 24 machine involved with him as well. The car of Chris Robinson there just pushed wide, nowhere really to go. Caught him and lost that car. Unfortunate end for Bidwell.
Well, so far in this race, we've seen the lead change three times. You can see down in your pad, we've actually got ourselves a lovely little scrap going on. Look at these five drivers separated by pretty much nothing. We do prefer the overhead cameras here at Monza because you get to see so much of this magnificent racetrack. But this is Mara Lawson, Clark Williams going side by side. They are too wide, going to head themselves too deep in towards turn one. There, they'll stay single file for just one moment then as they come down in towards turn one. And this is where you get the battles going. David Grenell down to the outside there. Stuart Adcock on the inside. Rachel, they changed places three times on that first lap, but behind, look at this wonderful battle going on. P3 all the way through to P8.
Absolutely, Will. Some exciting racing as we head out of Parabolica. These cars stacked and racked. This is awesome racing here from these guys. But they're Mark Turner at the back of this front pack as we have Adcock and Grunhill going too wide for the lead there. But it's Turner, Williams, Larson, Fraser, two wide, two rows deep, three rows deep, I apologise, as Antonides and Ward go side by side. Incredible racing here, as it will be Grunhill who leads through turn one.
Yeah, as they open themselves for the exit of the second chicane, down and towards the Lesmo they come now. So it's Grunhill still leading from Adcock. You see he's pulled out a little bit of a gap. That's not going to be that much. You won't be able to get any advantage here at this track at all, unless something crazy happens. We have seen that on Sunday Night Skippies, of course, but we do not expect to see that here tonight in the Club UK and Ireland Skip Barber Racing School Series in support of Shelter on RaceSpot TV. One car decided to go very, very wide at the rear end of that pack. I believe that was Russell Barnes, the number 15 machine. Indeed, yes, it was there in the number 35 machine, deciding to go a little bit too wide there on the exit of Lesmo number one. However, battle for the race lead, David Grunhill. He didn't lead officially at the end of lap number one, but he's at the lead of this motor race right now. We have a look from the rear of him. to the driver of Stuart Adcock. Not much at all is the gap right now. It's about, Rachel, 0.4 of a second.
0.4 of a second, and it could might as well be no time whatsoever. The draft is so big, these cars collect up so quickly. Last season, Will, I think we had a 0.01 second margin at the line, and that was between Avery and this season's champion-elect Tom Ward. So we expect the finish here will be tight and close. These guys certainly looking like it right now, but Adcock and Grinnell have pulled away somewhat from third position backwards, so we'll see what they can do as it's a three-way fight for P3.
Yeah, it's Rattle on board there with David Grunhill. He's not being able to get himself to the race lead at the end of that lap. Once again, you can see behind as well that I saw some interesting scraps going on. They are 1, 2, 3 wide in toward turn number one. They come. You got yourself the very bright pink car, number 94 machine there. That's Mark O'Connell. Mark Turner there in the mix as well. Number 15 car, Bill Fraser, also there in the action on the exit of the Variante Retrofilo. Now they work themselves down through Cover Grande. This is turn number three on the racetrack, down towards the second chicane. There are three distinct chicanes on this racetrack as we ride ourselves along board with Mark Turner right now. Your lap leaders were David Grunhill has led a lap, Stuart Adcock has led a lap in this race so far. But what we've noticed, Rachel, is already the gaps at the line. People are trying to see how close it will be as, oh, over the curve, that's going to be Mark Turner. Mark O'Connell there getting a slowdown penalty. That's going to drop in two positions as they're Mark Turner and Bill Fraser is going to move themselves up one spot inside of your top 10.
Yeah, they will indeed. This top 10 very tight right now. We've had a lot of cars falling back somewhat. We had Robinson, Patterson, Mickling and Bill all got damage on those cars, so they're running quite slow now. Bill's turning off the pace massively right now thanks to that incident he had earlier on, but his car has been repaired. I think he's just out of sequence, but that into his season. Further back in the pack though, Plumley and Watson and Maltby. Oh, three wide up here, and that's got Plumley. It's got, I believe that's contact there with the car of Simon Maltby as he was three wide into that corner. Three wide into a scar. It doesn't work any better than the Lesmos.
Yeah, as we just see that most of that incident. They do all survive. That's the important thing as they work themselves now down towards the final corner, the wonderful Parabolica corner. As you can see, Bill Fraser, Mark O'Connell is still trying to go at it out front. Stuart Adcock versus David Grunhill. This will complete lap number 3 of 12 here in Monday Night Skippies as they head themselves down towards the start finish line. Let's ride ourselves along board then with the driver of Stuart Adcock. As you can see, David Grunhill will work himself past. Gap at the line was 102 tenths of a second. Adcock back down into P2, but let's have a look further down. You can see they are scrapping for position. 1, 2, 3 wide and towards turn number one between Connell, Fraser and Turner once again, and this time by the outside line's going to work the best there. Number 94 car, the bright pink machine of Mark O'Connell, will lead these drivers out of the Variante Retrofilo, Rachel.
Yes, they will indeed. Here we come down Curva Grande now. Fast, flat out corner for these guys. It doesn't feel much like a corner in a car this speed. As we head down to the second chicane now, definitely still, I believe that's up ahead. That is the car of... No, it's not Mario Larson. I got that one backwards. That's Mark O'Connell leading those three ahead of Turner and Fraser. But this pack is, well, this is exactly our point, Will. Positions change so rapidly here over a lap. You can barely tell where anybody's actually running until they cross the stripe. And even then, it could still change up in the run to turn one. Lots of dicing in action right now up at the front. It's still Adcock from Grunnell. And, Tom Ward, Antonides and Larson are not catching up.
Yeah, and I'll tell you what, we're just having a look here. Antonides alongside the driver of Tom Ward. Ward up into the third position on the racetrack. That was a nice and easy pass. It's worth mentioning, Rachel, that we noticed yesterday that the driver of Richard Avery was not sporting Friction Racing colours, but instead the colours of Movano Thrustmaster X Team yesterday. That is going to be an interesting turn of events because, of course, into the back end of the Irish.com World Championship Grand Prix Series, we're into a new season of Monday Night Skippies, a new season of Sunday Night Skippies coming up. Richard Avery, this will be his third team in a year potentially now, after a season that saw him score a Sunday Night Skippy Championship. But we did see a little bit of dissension in that Friction Racing ranks along the course of this season.
Well, we have indeed, but it's going to be a new change for him. Movano are a predominantly Italian team, so could be some adjustment there for Avery, but, well, they're an upcoming strong team with cars running in the Drivers World Championship Series, so looking forward to seeing what he can do with those guys and if he'll have any more success, but we're not going to make any sort of Ferrari comments, but, you know.
We're here at Monza, so you never know. We can say anything.
Well, the Tifosi might be angry with us.
Yes, indeed so, as we ride ourselves along board there with Mara Lawson and turn P number 5 in the Martini machine there as they head themselves down in towards turn number 4. Exit of the curve, grinding down towards the second chicane. They come once again, getting ourselves close to halfway distance already here on RaceSpot TV. Of course, these races are about 25 minutes in length. We just have a look there behind the trees. You can see Stuart Adcock and David Grunhill. We'll just turn our camera around. You can see these drivers heading themselves down into the Lesman number 2. Let's ride the rest of this lap on board with the one and only Stuart Adcock. Rachel, talk us through it.
Yep, Stuart Adcock is up ahead now as we head through the second Lesmos, but great pass there, and that was right in the first Lesmos. Trying to get a camera angle. It doesn't involve trees, Will, as we stand, but coming up behind Grunhill there, Grunhill gets a little wide. Adcock gets it to much better exit and is able to fit past, but nicely executed pass. And oh, Grunhill actually grabs some gravel, and that's what that'll do to your car as he comes up behind him. Good short exit, gets the slingshot past.
Yep, so Adcock still leads away, they can see, but Grunhill is going to try and have a look back as they work themselves down in towards the curve of Parabolica. They do this, Rachel, at this stage of the race for one reason. They want to figure out where they want to be at the conclusion of lap number 12.
Absolutely, this is one of those tracks where you really have to pick that place and pick it carefully. There is an art form to when you make that pass from second for the race win to be able to hold it. We've seen races come down to Parabolica. We've seen races change exiting Parabolica. Though nothing is set in stone, but you can have a good go at chiseling it.
Well, we just saw that. Another pass made by Adcock down in towards turn and one. Grunhill going to pretty much get all the strips in he can, but Adcock will always be the first to break. Well, there you can see your top two drivers. These are your biggest movers and shakers in the race so far. Interestingly, Rachel, inside of your top 10, we've only had losers. Bill Fraser down 3 positions. No real gainers inside of your top 10 at all.
No, but we know these guys are some of the best Skip Barber races we've seen, and some of the best I've ever seen in iRacing.com history, myself. There's such an amazing pool of talent here, and some of the drivers who were somewhat in that mid-pack are now finding themselves solidly top 10 drivers, and I honestly love coming here every Monday night, watching these guys race, because it is a masterclass in racecraft. And this just says everything you need to see. Where people are qualifying is typically where they're running. These guys are that good. They are racing as hard as they can, and the talent level here is extremely high.
Yeah, we just saw that the end of a piece of action between Paul Thurston in the number 17 machine and Robert Plumley in the 147 car. This is Rachel on P number 12 and P13. We saw Plumley trying to get himself into the top 10 earlier. It didn't work out for him. Now he's got himself a bit of a battle from Paul Thurston just right behind him as they work themselves down towards the Variante Ascari.
Well, in true Ferrari fashion, Paul Thurston might be told not to pass Robert Plumley as he fights to close down on Tim Adcock ahead of him. But, yeah, I made a comment about that. What are you going to do?
Well, you know, commentators, we get to say what we want to say. We're journalistically exempt, shall they say. But here we have a look then on the exit of the Variante Ascari. Here we can see now the driver of Paul Thurston. Let's have a look at the speed chart. As they head themselves down into the curve of Parabolica. Well, there's overspeed. There's getting out of the gas, Rachel. I think you're right.
I think he is indeed. Well, you know, we could always say Plumley beat him by a nose.
Yeah.
No, great well, racing.
It would be Paul Thurston beating him by a nose by mistake, don't forget.
It would be, yes. But no, I genuinely think that Thurston's just staying in line because these guys are working together. It's nothing to do with team orders. They're working together. Look at the draft they're getting by staying in line here, passing Simon Maltby. this is the advantage you get with two cars working together on a track that's very draft intensive. As you see there, that will be Paul Thurston going past Plumley, but that was only to simply assist his teammate in getting past the other car that wasn't associated with them. And that's a major advantage for them. They can work together and have a team plan. But up ahead, we had some rather interesting shenanigans there, as I believe that was the car of Mark O'Connell losing a few spots, bouncing over curbs left, right and centre in turn one.
Yeah, let's go. Let's have a replay of that one as we speak there. O'Connell hard onto the brakes in towards turn one. Basically, he ran out of racetrack. He tried to outbreak the field. He tried to be John O'Lacy, Rachel. Lost the late breakers. It didn't work out for him. He's now down in P number 10.
Yes, he is indeed. And not where he'd like to be. He had a great fight going on with Turner, Fraser and Adcock. But, well, that's only brought him to the clutches of Plumley and Thurston now, as they're going to try and go after him to secure something exciting. Retirements from this race so far. Well, Pete Newman is out. And Gavin Hickling is also out. Adrian Bidwell, last of our runners at the moment. And he's nearly... half a lap back from your race leaders. It's not a great diet for him. Hoping a few more people will crash in the later laps, but as things stand, not much going for him. Further up though, Mark Turner trying to duke it out right now at the moment with Bill Fraser and Tim Adcock. They're heading down towards the Parabolica. It looks like we could have a pass here by Tim Adcock.
Yeah, we've also had ourselves a pass with Murray Lawson getting himself past the heat. Atenides, we ride ourselves on board then with Atenides on the exit of the Parabolica. There are 5 laps left of the season to go this time. By down in towards turn and one they come. And this is why we love Monday Night Skippies, because it is oh so unpredictable. There is Maltby versus Plumley versus Watson as he tries to head himself down in towards that first corner once again. This is what we see, Rachel. A lot of drivers working in tandem, but here we go, 1, 2, 3 wide then, down past the start finish line, 17, 16, 147 cars, side by side, in towards turn one, and the winner of this battle is going to be Robert Plumley, I think, on the outside. If he can hold it together, yep, he will.
Just about holding it there for Plumley, as that was, are you going to break? No. Oh, are you going to break? I don't know, are you going to break? It was one of those moments of, who decides last? Plumley had the optimal line there, which gave him the run through the corner. The other guys had to lift a little earlier just to make the apex. That was enough advantage for him to get clear, and a great pass by Robert Plumley.
Yep, so Plumley is looking strong here on Monday Night Skippies. Our onboard coverage here today is brought to you by the iRacing.com forum app for Android. It would help if we actually put the right banner up. There you are! Onboard coverage provided by the iRacing Forum app from Android. Download it now from the Google Play Store. If you're an iOS user, well, you might be able to use Android Wear, but you can't get the iRacing Forum app for Android because it's for Android. Figure it out.
Well, I thought it was for Apple iOS, Will. Glad you cleared that up.
I'm not going to lie to you. You can now get Android Wear for iOS, so I'm a happy bunny.
You must be, unfortunately. Just don't drop your bunny and you'll be okay. But looking up at the front of this race right now, it's still Stuart Adcock leading from David Grunnell. No, it's Grunnell leading from Adcock. It changes every lap. But more importantly, Tom Ward has caught them. Tom Ward right on the back of those two. They've been fighting hard side by side. That's allowed the friction racing machine of Ward to catch right up to the leaders. And now that two-way battle's become a three.
Indeed, it's become a three-way here. It's between Stuart Adcock, David Gunhill and Tom Ward. Battle for your race lead. I'm not going to lie to you, Rachel. I've never dropped a bunny, but I have lost a rabbit. Here is Stuart Adcock. Here is David Gunhill. Here is Tom Ward. They're going to go one. They're going to go two. Are they going to go three wide in towards turn number one? It's going to be Gunhill and Adcock in towards turn number one. They come there. As it's going to be Adcock potentially. No, he won't. It will be Gunhill leading the way once again. And from here on in, Rachel, you are playing the waiting game. You're going to wait as long as possible before you try to explode to the front of the field. This is what Adcock and Ward want to do. Figure out where they're going to be on the exit of the Parabolica on their final lap when they need to squirt it to the line.
Absolutely, Will. And, well, it's going to be a very important time for these guys. They all gang up on David Grunnell there, but it's going to be very tricky for him to secure this one, as he's put under serious stress and pressure by Adcock and Tom Ward as they are desperate to try and find a way of beating him.
Indeed so, as they work themselves on the exit. Now turn Lesmer number one into Lesmer number two. They come, they go very wide. Both the drivers are Grunhill and Adcock as if a little bit scared about what's going to happen next. But here you can see, we're going to ride ourselves on along with Tom Ward. 3.5 laps to go. Rachel, talk us through the back end of this lap.
Well, this lap is a long run down from the second Lesmos now towards the Ascari complex, possibly the best set of corners in motor racing. The fast left, right, left as you head down then towards Parabolica. That big 180 degree corner, it feels like you're turning forever. So long without the power on. Get that power down and that long drag out towards the start finish line. Lap is complete. All looks and seems fairly simple. Probably one of the most tense corners in racing. Looking back towards the front of the field right now, it's still Stuart Adcock in P2 chasing David Grunnell for that first position. Tom Ward in third, he's not doing anything just yet, he's content to sit in place. Well, but here we go, Adcock to the inside will pass very easily for the lead.
Yeah, we're actually looking at Tom Ward, we're looking at the speed chart there. The speed chart difference isn't as much as what we saw on Sunday Night Skippies. The draft is not as prevalent. That means, Rachel, you've got to be pretty much alongside down into Parabolica if you want to get yourself a race victory here today.
Oh, absolutely. It's the final race of the season. You get that prestige, it would be the final round, and always the wait until the off-season. You want to leave a mark and stamp your authority before the new season starts. And well, David Grunnell has had a great season so far this year, Will. He's really improved over this last season, and I'm really looking forward to seeing what he can do here in the next season as a consistent front runner. But as we see there, back to the front in front of Stuart Adcock. Run through Curva Grande was key for that. Just going to stop himself from running wide of the gravel like he did there, and he might actually hold this victory.
Yeah, they can see a look from our aerial coverage, and you can see just how tree-lined this racetrack is actually laid, Rachel. You know, it's very difficult to actually get some decent camera angles here at times because there are so many trees here at Monza.
Absolutely, yeah. Let's chop all those down as we tilkify the circuit. But
don't say that.
No, no, of course. Trees are one of the beautiful things about Monza. The tree-lined straights here, like the run from the second Lesmos down towards Ascari, diving under the old oval circuit. That's one of the most recognizable and beautiful straights in racing. I think it's an integral part of the circuit, and you know, with a safe distance from the track and behind barriers, trees really add an organic element to race circuits. These big, flat, wide, open circuits like the circuit car park of the Americas just doesn't have the same history and character without a forest.
You want me to tie this in responsibly, Rachel?
Go on then.
Ladies and gentlemen, coming soon to iRacing is Dynamic Tracks, where for the first time in iRacing.com history, you'll be able to understand how the track evolves over the course of the race. If there are trees in the way, well, you'll get the shade, and the shade will affect the amount of grip that you have on the racetrack. If you got yourself a NASCAR track, you can get the rubber building up, it'll go to the outside of the racetrack, and that will mean you get more grip on the inside and less grip on the outside. It's coming your way tomorrow, only on iRacing.
Don't forget though, to link in seamlessly from my forest comment, we're also getting the new tree model from iRacing. So tree model version 2 coming soon to iRacing.
Yeah.
Well, tomorrow, like we just said. New trees. No longer will you see these no longer will you get those overhead square trees like an X. We're gonna get fully fledged trees and hopefully still have frame rates left.
The trees will be so beautiful as you've got three drivers side by side. David Grunhill, Tom Ward, Stuart Adcock, battle for the race lead. 1.5 laps to go into the second chicane they come. It'll be Ward from Grunhill, from Adcock. Ward leads in the first time here today, Rachel.
He does indeed. He took his time and he picked it carefully, but could have gone off too soon there for Tom Ward. This could be a little premature, in fact, in his regard, but look in the background, that's Fahim Antonides stalking this front three, should anything go wrong here, but, well, Grunnell and Adcock certainly in a prime position to jump on Tom Ward here. Should they work together? They probably will, but it'll certainly be interesting.
Paul Thurston, Simon Maltby, we just saw that there, had themselves a little bit of a coming together down at this second chicane. one and a half laps to go down into the second Les Mis. Maltby is going to push wide. It does look as though that car will be able to continue. For the time being, Robert Plumley, for the time being, is 1.7 seconds back. But our attention has to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cars separated by 1 second as they come down to Parabolica for the penultimate time in this event. Well, Rachel, about 2 minutes, I'm going to be going a little bit crazy. So you talk me through towards a white flag.
I will indeed, as we come towards the white flag now through Parabolica, and that is David Grenell on the inside there of Stuart Adcock. That's how easily they passed the car of Tom Ward. But, well, here comes the draft. Here comes Tom Ward. He's boxed in between Adcock and Grenell. Can he go anywhere? Of course he can. Let's go three wide in the finale here of the You Can Ask It Barbers. But wait, that is Mario Larson. That is Fahim Antonides. They are in this one now. Two cars became four, just like that, as Antonides right up behind him. Here comes Larson to make it 5, 3 by 2. This is like a Red Arrows formation now as we begin that white flag lap here. And contact there between Larson and Antonides. That is not what they needed. And that will probably lock those guys out of the podium. Something that will not be best pleasing for Antonides. But here we go. It's Ward in the lead. He's in the weakest spot. Under attack now from Tom Ward and Stuart Adcock. Will, take it away.
Yeah, I'm just having a look there. That Larson seems to have more damage than Fahim Antonides. He's got himself a 10.1 second advantage over Clark Williams. He may be able to hold on to P5. That is his only hope now in this event. Your top three drivers, Tom Ward, 09, Friction Racing car, leads the way. David Grenhill in second and Stuart Adcock in third. We're going to ride ourselves on board with David Grenhill because this race, well, it's going to get interesting on the exit of this corner here. This is Les Mis number 2. Anyone remember Lewis Hamilton versus Michael Schumacher at this section of the racetrack? Some of the greatest attempts at overtaking in modern Grand Prix history. And Grenhill is going to try and do the same thing. He's looking to the outside as they come down into the Variante Ascari for the final time. Grenhill round the outside. Can it make it work? The answer's no, not yet. Side by side with Adcock has run himself through the Ascari chicane. But now it's all going to be, what can they do as they come down towards the Parabolica for the final time in today's event. Now, as it stands, Ward has the advantage, but Grenhill and also Adcock are closing up in the final corner. You can see Ward there taking a defensive line. And you can see Grenhill looking down to the inside. Oh, we've got a car around. There's David Grenhill around. We've got Tom Ward. He's on the racetrack. Stuart Adcock will keep it going as well. Who will be the race winner? It looks as though it'll be Tom Ward who'll claim victory from the driver of Stuart Adcock. But Rachel, controversy once again at the final moments of the race. The driver of David Grenhill falling well down the field.
Yeah, he loses that place to Fahim Antonides, but not to Mario Larson. David Grenhill, heartbroken in his final moments, coming down towards Parabolic. Hopefully we have a replay up of that. Goes to the inside. Tom Ward takes a very tight defensive line there into Parabolica, which I'm not sure he needed to do with the room he had at the time, but Grenhill puts his nose there. Gets tapped by the rear quarter of Tom Ward, gets the car upset, and round he goes. Heartbreak for David Grenhill, off the podium by one spot, and just heartbreak. But Tom Ward, your season champion, will come home today as a race victor here at Monza. Stuart Adcock, Antonides sneaks onto the podium with Grenhill's mistake. Clark Williams brings it home, P number 5. Fraser, Turner, O'Connell, Adcock, because you know what? Well, Mario Larson pulled off the track.
Well, I'm not going to lie to you, Rachel. We just drew a line there. And I'm going to have to say that Tom Ward did come across the driver of David Grenhill there.
Yes, he probably did, actually. Just watching this last lap back, by the way, Will. Larson didn't pull off. He actually went off at the second Les Mis there and just plowed into the barriers. So not the end he would have wanted, but the damage he had it. Yeah, I think you're right. Tom Ward did squeeze, possibly unnecessarily. It's tough to say, but that could have been an epic finish to this race. I think he had enough distance that he didn't need to defend so hard. You saw him all the way to the right and the run down to Parabolica. He had such gap, it wasn't necessary. I think with the wider entry into the corner anyway, even if Grenhill was alongside him, he'd have had the preferred line and the speed, so not the ending we'd have liked, but it's the ending we got, and, well, the champion wins the race.
Well, I'm just going to slow it for you right about here, and I'm going to talk about track lanes, Rachel, because I'm going to try and draw out a lane here, and this is going to be lane number one, right about here. Coming down into the corner. The reason why I drew that a little bit wider is because you take a wide angle into the corner, it tightens up for the apex. You'll notice here that at this point, that looks about right between the car on the outside line and the car in the middle. Now, I'm just going to reset all of this for you, and we just want to pay attention to that gap here between the middle car, which is Tom Ward, and David Gronhill on the inside. Now, it doesn't look like much, Rachel, and I'm just trying to try and get this one to go as slowly as we possibly can to explain what happened. David Gronhill does not have to hug the curb. He has got a third of the racetrack, which is essentially his. Now, what's happened is that Tom Ward's coming to the part of the racetrack, which David Gronhill can easily say is his part of the racetrack. We're just going to cycle this forward, and this is about one half of a second right about here. And you can see that David Gronhill has already been spun. The reason for that one is, Rachel, because of the fact that Tom Ward has come across into that inside lane that you can see here. And, well, there's really nowhere for the driver of David Gronhill to go. Even if he was to be on the inside line at that point, I'm going to try and draw that inside line for you right about now. I don't think, even if Gronhill was running perfectly in the inside, I don't think that Gronhill would have actually been able to avoid contact.
I don't think he would, Will. I think this is a Hunter Ray, Bastien Bourdais, NOLA Motorsports Park moment of there being room for three cars, but the car in the middle not giving the car on the inside his entitled room, let's say. And I do think he was entitled to it. If Tom Ward was wider into that corner, he'd have actually had more speed and carried through the corner. He already compromised. Gronhill probably wouldn't have been able to pass him. But by squeezing down that hard in a place where it is to be expected that David Gronhill will push up, I think Tom Ward invited that, not necessarily intentionally, but it was going to happen at that point because he couldn't hold it that tight to the corner. That's not a weakness of David Gronhill. That's a fact of the car reached its limit of grip and was beyond it. It wasn't given room it perhaps needed. But of course, he would have had to slow up more and would have lost the position. So if Tom Ward had left him more room, Gronhill would have had to slow down. He would have still come out the corner first.
Yeah.
So no necessity to do that. And puts a bit of a sour end on the season. Like I say, it's not a vicious thing. It's just a racing room thing. And I don't suppose either driver will be too happy with it, but the way it goes. And we are impartial here at RaceSpot TV. We're not on anybody's particular side. If this had been somebody else, it'd be the same thing. You know, gotta say, Tom Ward's driven a flawless season. He's the race season champion, and he deserves it. But at the same time, you know, different drivers with different speeds, different drivers get faster sooner and differently. Gronhill has found himself in the top five more and more this season than he has in the past. And I think it's perhaps just getting used to how other people race thing as much as they get used to how he races. So there's more for everyone to learn from this one as you draw boob on the racetrack, it seems.
I didn't actually mean to do that. I was trying to explain something there. It's that you can see that the optimal line would have been through lane number two or lane number three. I just drew a second line there, which would show the orange line, which would show how I would take that corner. You take a high entry into turn three, so into the final corner. You would tighten it up through the apex of the corner to give yourself momentum and the track position out of the corner. Now, the outside line is bad, because if you touch the outside line, you've got yourselves, and I'm just going to highlight this for you as well, you've got yourselves the horrific curbing right about there. You do not want to touch that curb, because if you do, you're going to hit yourself on the actual curb. You might even spin. Same time, you don't want to hit yourself on the inside curb, because the inside curb will slow your car down. You will lose the motor race. So you're generally always going to stay about as much as you can outside of that first curb. And you essentially, Rachel, want to get as close as you can to that white line. Now, ironically, that is where the number 02 car is, right there. But he's pointing in the wrong direction. He's 45 degrees almost in the wrong direction. But Tom Ward does win the championship. He was winning the championship as he came into this event, and for better and for worse, he is a champion, and that's the important factor out of this season. He did win when it mattered.
Yes, he did indeed, and like I said, he's had a flawless season. He's been a great performer, one of the real stars of this season. He's had a great evolution as well. I mean, I remember him coming into the season, this series, and he's had a great rise, and he honestly deserves this championship. He was involved in it last time around with Sebastian Jobe and lost out to Jobe, of course, but it's an incredible season for him and really impressive run. I can't wait for next season, Will.
Yeah. And you know what? Another season is going to start in just 2 weeks' time. Just having a look there at another look to see David Gunhill in super slow motion. Ladies and gentlemen, this has been the first season that we've done this one in support of Shelter, the official charity of RaceSpot TV. In about seven and a half months' time. Yes, Rachel?
Before we go, I'd just like to give a bit of a public service announcement actually for our viewers. The build you were talking about earlier today with the long-awaited new tree model with the new leaf physics will not be coming tomorrow. It is in fact coming on Wednesday this week. Wednesday the 9th of September. It's been put off by a day, probably for the Peak Antifree series, but it's been put off by one day. It will now be released on Wednesday the 9th.
Rachel, it's not because of the Peak Antifree series. It's because of the fact that Iris and Coon get a table at Golden Corral. Get it right.
It's, yeah, probably something to do with Golden Corral.
Yes. We can see that David Gunhill, that super slow-mo of him crashing out of P2. But ladies and gentlemen,
just to remind him.
Yeah, just to remind him one more time. As well, it has been another season here of Monday Night Skippies here on RaceSpot TV. It's been an emotional series on Monday Night Skippies. And just as another PSA, for anyone who is wondering about what's happening with Justin Wilson and his family and the funeral, it's taking place this coming Thursday. Now, if you are in and around the Northamptonshire area, then the funeral is going to be taking place around there. It will be taking place this coming Thursday, and it is going to be taking place about 3 miles north of Potter Street. The reason why I know this is because it's where I actually used to live, in Potter Street. So if you were to head out of where I used to live, head up the A5, go past the Super Sausage Cafe, and then turn left in Paulsbury, that is where Justin Wilson's funeral will be taking place this coming Thursday. Now, they are saying if you do want to go to the funeral, please make sure that you let them know in advance. Any fan of IndyCar is welcome to that funeral, I guarantee. And I know that they will never turn any true racing fan away for paying the last respects to Justin Wilson. So if you can go this Thursday, unfortunately I can't, but if you can, then please feel free to do so. And this season is in honour of the gentle giant who unfortunately lost his life at Pocono just a couple of weeks ago. And it's such a shame to lose two UK drivers in 5 years in IndyCar, but that series will carry on. That series will get safer. I goddamn guarantee it. And there's many people who will want to make that series safer, who will want to make sure that becomes the greatest series in all of racing. But we will come back in 2 weeks' time. Next week is week 13. Week 13 means we take a week off. They might rope us into the week 13 event, but if we don't, we'll see you in 2 weeks' time. What will be our sixth season here on Monday Night Skippies, as we once again bring you coverage of one of the most exciting events that you will see in all of sim racing. It will take place, once again, at 8 p.m. GMT, until the point that, Rachel, we stop being GMT and we go back to what they normally call GMT. You know what I mean, don't you?
Well, you mean stop going from British Summertime to actual GMT, rather than GMT plus one will now be GMT.
Yes.
So we fall back to normal time. Yay! Normal time.
Basically, what it means is that Rachel actually knows what time and date is.
That is true. I have real trouble in the summer.
Yeah.
Most of my brain overheats, to be honest.
And ladies and gentlemen, if you want more information about the Justin Wilson funeral, it is going to be at 11:45 a.m. on September the 10th at St. James the Great Church in Paulsbury, Northamptonshire, England. That'll be NN12 7DB, if my postcode reminds me correctly. That is in Paulsbury, Northamptonshire, England. That is Paulersbury in Northamptonshire, England. I know for certain it's NN12. If you head up the A5 from Milton Keynes, it is about 3 miles away from Paulsbury. But thank you very much for being a part of UK and Ireland Monday Night Skippies into Port of Shelter all season long. Many of you are in the car fans. We will all send our greatest specs out to Justin this coming Thursday. Back with you for an upcoming season. That'll be in just 2 weeks' time. Thank you very much for watching. We'll talk to you all next time. Don't forget the Justin Wilson 150 RaceSpot TV this coming Saturday. Remember, the gentle drying. Talk to you in a bit. Bye.